Well into this in question and answer.
Thank you, Premal. So I'm going to quickly run through how we manage ping pulseless hand at Coimbatore here. So before going on to the talk, I just want the audience participation in a clinical decision making. We have two patients here, both of them with these injuries, and close reduction and pinning has been done. So that's the how the hand looks after pinning. So and I want your opinion to say which is ping and which is fail. One of them is patient A is having a median nerve injury, patient B is not having. Please pick up your voting pads. So please help me to decide. So most of you feel that A is pink and B is pale.
Well, okay, very few people are answering. There are a lot of people and we've got only 46 answers. So I think we need, I think they have all pads. I think you should next time use them.
So anyway, I'll come to the story what happened to these patients a little later. So conventionally we define pink pulseless hand is a hand that remains pulseless after close reduction and pinning with a supracondylar humerus fracture, and as Professor Crawford said, the management is controversial. We have a lot of papers supporting exploration and equal number of papers supporting observation, and the AAOS guidelines in 2010 reads that we cannot recommend for or against open exploration in a pink pulseless hand. So we did this little small study couple of years back when Sandeep invited to write a review article. So from 2003 to 2015, we had about 521 supracondylar type 3 fractures, out of which 35 presented with pulseless supracondylars on presentation. So in 13 of them, the pulse returned after close reduction and pinning, but in the other 22, the pulse remained unpalpable after close reduction and pinning. So these were the classical pink pulseless hand. Out of these, 17 were just observed. The rest 5 were explore. So we just took the case sheets and then just tried to analyze how the decision making was done between observation and exploration. So the clinical examination findings like color of the hand and capillary refilling time, and most of the case sheets had SpO2 recordings and Doppler. We have a handheld Doppler. I'll just show how we do that. So we divided into two groups, whether just a subjective assessment based on looking at the hand and the perfusion and the capillary refilling time, or an objective assessment in terms of looking at the pulse oximeter signals and radial artery Doppler. So this is a patient example after close reduction and pinning. I hope the video plays. So this is a good waveform that we call as good waveform and good saturation. So if this is seen, we usually believe that the distal perfusion is good. So this waveform indicates that the distal circulation is good. The same patient, when we try to do the radial, this is the handheld Doppler which we use, which is readily available in our emergency department itself, the fourth floor. So, but I was not able to pick up the radial signals in this handheld Doppler. But you can see that the perfusion was really good on the pulse oximeter signals. So this is the ulnar artery. So I hope you can hear the... So when this Doppler signals are picked up, we are quite sure that the distal circulation is good, and this patient was just observed. So when we look back, all the patients, the decision making was based on only objective assessment. All the observation patients, 17 of them have documented that there was good pulse waveforms in the SpO2 signals were more than 95%. 10 of them had radial artery Doppler signals. So in our series, about 20% of them, that is 1 in 5 pink pulseless hand landed up in exploration, and of these 5, only 2 had a significant arterial injury which needed reconstruction. So it is quite contrasting to the systematic review which was published by Professor Alvin Crawford, in which they had 70% of them had a significant brachial artery injury. So these are the patients who had 5 explorations. The radial artery Doppler signals was negative in all of them. Pulse oximeter signal was less than 80 and with irregular waveforms. 4 out of 5 had associated median nerve injury. In 2 of them, one of them had a brachial artery rupture which was done end-to-end repair, and one needed a vein grafting. 3 were just kinking of the vessels of the fracture. So these are the 2 patients which I had put initially. The first patient, complete brachial artery injury which needed a saphenous vein graft. And second patient also remained actually pale and pulseless. So he also was taken up for exploration, and you can see that the vessels were kinked at the fracture site. So once it was released, the pulse came back. Just a word on median nerve injury, and we have papers now recommending that if you have a pulse, pink pulseless hand with associated median nerve injury, it is better to do an exploration rather than observing. So in our series, we found that 80% of the patients who underwent exploration had associated median nerve injury. But in the other group, in the patients whom we observed, 6 of the patients had median nerve injury. That is like 35% of the patients with a pink pulseless hand with the median nerve injury did well with just observation. So it is not a good idea to just look at the median nerve function and then make a hasty decision to go out explore. So this is the article which we wrote up in IJPO a couple of years back. So we look at the objective assessment of perfusion in terms of good pulse oximeter waveforms, SpO2 of more than 95%, presence of radial artery or ulnar artery Doppler signals, and intact median nerve function, and then decide. Thank you.